The future, vividly imagined in popular media, is a world full of sleek, sophisticated gadgetry, robots, miracle medicine, and probably coolest of all, personal flying cars. The future is oftentimes envisioned as a utopia which has discarded and discontinued the use of pollution-causing fossil fuels. I would also go a step further in this vision and include the minimization of the use of asphalt. Asphalt is a concern, especially when it is being laid and cured, as the chemicals that it is made up of are carcinogens, which end up in the air and are carried by rainwater into the ground and water freshwater systems. They may even end up in our farming soil. In being able to travel with no contact with the ground, asphalt could be all but eliminated. The ideal city would be a futuristic eco-city, which merges technology, natural landscape, as well as foliage. For instance, imagine cell phone towers which look like tall trees and bushes. But why this far into the 21st century do we not have anything like flying cars in the sky? The technology exists, but one of the main reasons could be practical safety. Flying cars will obviously be hazardous, as the inevitable mid-air collisions would threaten not only the flyers, but also people on the ground by the falling debris. The better idea would be for the vehicle to fly only several feet above the ground. This conjures questions of lift type. If the vehicle was relying on the principle of the airfoil, then it would only achieve lift at a certain forward speed. This could be potentially dangerous, as sudden atmospheric disturbances could cause the craft to shift up, or worse, fall several feet right into the ground. This is not so much of a problem with an airplane several miles up in the sky, but for a vehicle so close to the ground and traveling at such high speed, this would be potentially catastrophic. A type of ground effect would be needed to make low-flying vehicles safe and practical. When we think of ground effect machines, we may think of vehicles such as hovercrafts and maglev trains, or even the anti-gravity repulsings seen in the land speeder vehicles in the Star Wars franchise. Anti-gravity like that seen in Star Wars would actually be the holy grail of travel. We could all but imagine just an exciting mastery over gravity, such that vehicles both small and massive could be made to easily hover several feet above the Earth's surface without any apparent continuous input power, just as a superconductor floats over a magnet due to flux pining. But unfortunately, if it is even possible at all, we haven't yet discovered the techniques to practical anti-gravity, at least not in the public sector. But is there any way to at least approximate the effects of anti-gravity using the technology and techniques that we currently have? In the 70s and 80s, a brilliant electrical engineer by the name of Eric Lathwaite, also known as the father of maglev, and his team experimented heavily with linear motors and electromagnetic levitation, particularly the type of levitation described by Lenz's law. Professor Lathwaite was able to levitate heavy plates of non-ferrous metals like aluminum up to 11 inches in the air using electromagnetic coils energized by powerful alternating currents. This maglev technology pretty much approximates the anti-gravity or repulsing effects as seen in Star Wars and other futuristic movies. To enhance this effect even further, the previously mentioned idea of merging technology with the natural landscape could be employed. In this case, the bottom part of the maglev system, whether it be composed of flux generators or tracks of non-ferrous metals, magnets, or superconductors, or all of the above, could be cleverly camouflaged just under the ground, given the incredible visual of a vehicle floating in mid-air just above the Earth. So the attempt here was to visualize the concept of what I call the personal levitation vehicle, or PLV for short. hidden underneath the foliage and some potting soil, is the platform portion of a magnetic levitation display. The disc magnet is floating right over the hidden platform, and I added a small toy vehicle on top to invoke the image of a small vehicle hovering just above the earth as if by anti-gravity. But of course, this is only a static system. In order to create a dynamic system capable of propelling a vehicle across the earth's surface, we have to delve deeper into the maglev research of Professor Eric Lathwaite. In Lathwaite's groundbreaking research into magnetic levitation, he built a series of flux generators and two tracks. The flux generators were coils of magnet wire wrapped around iron cores and energized by powerful alternating currents. By manipulating the sequence of coil activation, he was able to lift and propel pieces of non-ferrous metal plates of aluminum. Using the principles of Lenz's law, he was able to float heavy plates from a couple of inches up to nearly a foot above the flux generators, even theorizing that levitation heights of 2 feet were achievable. Lathwaite and his team's work may have actually been the real-life inspiration behind the concept of the hoverboard in the 1989 movie Back to the Future 2. In one of the movie's 30-year anniversary extras, the hoverboard is actually said to be based on maglev technology, though it did not go into any actual detail. In my previous videos, I discussed the principles of sonic levitation and propulsion on a small scale, and also theorized on how it may be made viable on a much larger scale. Sonic vibration systems actually have analogous circuit elements to those in electrical, magnetic, and pneumatic systems, and as such can be harnessed as a potential motive power. In the figure here are two energetic resonators. The diagram on the left is a typical Helmholtz acoustic resonator, and we see that it has elements of a source of energy, a structure which sets the resonant frequency, and a conduit for that energy flow. Elements of resistance are implied, which is directly proportional to the cross-sectional area and inversely proportional to the length of the system. The system is the same is true of the electrical system on the right. Magnetic systems also can be represented as circuits. Resistance to flux in magnetic circuits is known as reluctance. Reluctance represents the opposition to magnetic flux and depends on the geometry as well as the composition of elements in the magnetic system. For instance, steel materials of relatively large cross-sectional area and short lengths will have low reluctance and enable the development of dense and powerful magnetic fields. The document here entitled Phenomena, Theory, and Applications of Near-Field Acoustic Levitation essentially describes an acoustical version of Eric Lathwaite's maglev system. In it are several diagrams of a vibrational platform upon which a flat planar object rests. A sonic transducer is attached to one of the terminal appendages of the platform, while the other appendage appears to function as an energy sink. This arrangement produces what are called asymmetric vibrations. This means that the vibrations are stronger in one region of the platform and become progressively weaker the further from the source. So in other words, a vibrational gradient. The object is not only levitated, but is also propelled in the direction of the traveling wave. The object is not moving because it is in contact with the platform, but because of the viscosity of the vibrating fluid, in this case the air, which is levitating the object as well as propelling it along. Now we can compare this to the concept of the magnetic river, which was a term coined by Eric Lathwaite to describe the lifting and propulsion of metals in his maglev system. In my previous acoustic lubrication videos, I demonstrated a similar type of propulsion of a heavy sled, which was not levitated, but experienced unidirectional movement due to its frictional contact with moving surface particles, which traveled in waves. I was also able to demonstrate that sonic vibrations can attract and repel objects. So levitation, attraction, repulsion, and propulsion are all possible with vibrations, just as they are with electromagnetism. But because our modern technology is based primarily on electromagnetism, there are much more developed techniques and materials to harness this force as a motive power than there are to harness sonic vibrations. Probably the main impediment to developing sound as a motive source involves the severe limits on the amount of energy which can be developed using current transducers and resonators. Present sonic devices suffer from what is called acoustic saturation. This occurs when attempting to increase the amount of energy in the acoustic driver. As the input energy increases, multiple harmonics of the drive frequency are produced, which then form shock waves, thus decreasing any further energy increases in acoustic power. Now, this acoustic saturation is actually very similar to what is known as magnetic saturation in magnetic circuits. At high magnetic fluxes, the ferromagnetic materials that are used for the cores of these circuits saturate, limiting the further increases in the magnetic flux through those materials. In discussing applications of sonic power, it is prudent to bring up John Worrell Keeley, a Philadelphian inventor who experimented with sonics in the late 1800s. Keeley reported a number of feats using sonic vibrations, including disintegration of matter, the rotating of powerful motors, the development of colossal pressures for use in cannons and other devices, as well as macrosonic levitation, among many other astounding claims. These claims, if possible, or if true, actually go far beyond anything accomplished with sonic vibrations in more recent history. All of these processes are indeed possible on a small scale, but to accomplish them on a scale comparable to Keeley would require the generation of vibrations of enormous power. Interestingly, Keeley reported geometries which could greatly intensify sound pressures without adding additional energy. This actually circles back to the shock waves and acoustic saturation mentioned earlier. Is it possible to fashion devices of certain geometric shapes which could mitigate or prevent the production of these shock waves? It appears that this may indeed be the case. In this very interesting article entitled Sound Power Comes of Age, Tim Lucas, president and CEO of a company called Macrosonics, reports the development of acoustic drivers which could revolutionize the use of sound power in industry and commercial applications. Lucas tackled the problem of sound power from the perspective of harmonic wave formation. He viewed the shock wave as the sum of other higher frequency waves called harmonics. He discovered that for resonant sound waves, the cavity through which the sound waves travel is the most important factor in determining the shape of the wave. By manipulating the acoustic resonator geometry, Lucas generated sound waves capable of carrying high amounts of power without acoustic saturation. Here is both a diagram and a production of these unique resonators. Another picture apparently shows one of them in use. Now, what's curious about these devices is their shape. As one can see, that they appear to be miniature versions of similar devices Keeley was using over 100 years ago. Notice the large bulbous shapes in the picture. The next picture is a modern reproduction of a Keeley engine by Dale Pond, one of the authors of Sympathetic Vibratory Physics, Universal Laws Never Before Revealed, a very fascinating book. In this photo, we see the same bulbous shapes on a miniaturized scale. So if we wish to build personal levitating vehicles, it appears that sound vibrations could be another potential source of motivity, along with air pressure and electromagnetism. Now, when discussing these various methods of levitation, especially those involving magnetism, it is hard not to consider the question of utilizing the Earth's magnetic field for this purpose. Is the geomagnetic field strong enough and stable enough to be interacted with by ordinary flux generators? The article here describes an experiment conducted by NASA in testing an unconventional form of space propulsion called the EM drive. The device was intended to work by bouncing microwaves around on the inside of a large enclosed cavity. The team actually did achieve small amounts of thrust, but it was not caused by the microwave bombardments. Instead, the thrust was caused by interaction between the geomagnetic field and the currents flowing through the power cables located inside of the chamber. So at least we can see that the geomagnetic field can indeed be harnessed to produce small thrust. But could magnetic interactions be amplified enough to lift and propel a vehicle? When we think about running an experiment to test this theory, we might envision using a coil or solenoid and immersing it in a magnetic field, in this case the Earth's magnetic field. But this setup would not be particularly unique, as it is basically the principle of the DC motor. The current flowing into the coil in one direction would experience a force in one direction, while experiencing the equal but opposite force on its return back to the power source. Thus, we might expect to experience a torque on the coil rather than a definitive upward or downward force, which would counteract the weight of the coil. Now, where this would definitely work would be just outside of the Earth's magnetic field. And in fact, this principle is used in what is called magnetotorquers. Magnetotorquers are simply flux generators or solenoids placed on the bottoms of satellites, which when energized are either attracted to or repelled from the Earth's magnetic field. By controlling these small thrusts via an onboard computer or a remote operating system, the positioning of the satellite can be precisely controlled. Now, in actuality, the propulsive forces of the geomagnetic field are observed on a regular basis by simply observing the actions of the field on a compass. The compass, of course, responds to the horizontal component of the Earth's magnetic field. This horizontal component is strongest at the equator and grows progressively weaker the further we move away from the equator and towards the Earth's magnetic poles. Now, a similar device, which is less of a household name than the compass, is what is known as the dip needle. This device responds to the vertical component of the Earth's magnetic field. This vertical component is strongest at the Earth's magnetic poles, where the dip needle will align itself nearly vertically with the natural flux lines. The dip needle, however, will be non-responsive at the equator. It will simply be horizontal. So in my early geomagnetics research, I heard of an experiment where a magnet stack was suspended horizontally from its center with a string, with the result that the magnet stack would not remain perfectly horizontal, but that it would be slightly slanted down to one side, presumably due to the interaction with the geomagnetic field, thus suggesting the possibility of a significant vertical magnetic component. To test this idea further, I attempted to make an electromagnetic dip needle. This was simply a coil of magnet wire wrapped around a long poker nail. Suspending the nail from its center, like so, and energizing it with several hundred volts of rectified DC, one end of the poker would swing downward each time the switch was closed. Timing the closing of the switch with the natural period of the setup will yield a greater and greater downward magnitude. Just as small pushes to a heavy swing at the right intervals increases its displacement. Reversing the polarity causes the poker to dip in the opposite direction. With a moderate success of this experiment, I then attempted to do the same with a coil of wire. This setup requires several hundred turns of 34-gauge magnet wire around a 3.5-inch diameter cardboard core. The coil was attached to the end of a wooden dowel, and with said dowel suspended by a string. Small weights were arranged on the opposite end to balance out the contraption. So even though a previous prediction of a torque on a coil wire immersed in the geomagnetic field would likely occur, this experiment actually does seem to show a definitive vertical force each time the swing is closed. The current in one direction causes a downward dip, while a reversal of the current causes an upward swing. And thus we can see again that it is polarity dependent. I'm not certain if this vertical movement rather than the predicting torquing movement is due to the small size of the coil, or the relatively low power I'm currently using, or for some other reason. I haven't experimented very much in this area yet, but perhaps constructing coils of much larger cross-sectional area and as well as higher power input might yield some answers, or at least some models. A more predictable method for modeling the behavior of a current-carrying conductor within the geomagnetic field is just a simple straight wire with the current flowing in one direction rather than flowing in a loop like in a coil. Taking the formula for the force of a magnetic field on a wire and knowing the relative strength of the geomagnetic field, which is 5 times 10 to the negative 5th Tesla, we can calculate the force exerted between the interaction of the two fields. A good method would be actually to decide how much force we would like to achieve and then work backwards. So if we wanted a lifting force of about 1 ton and we had a thick near superconducting conductor that is 9 feet long, lying horizontally on the ground, then we can determine how much current would be required to achieve this. Equating 1 ton to 8,896.44 newtons and 9 feet to 2.74 meters, and also assuming an angle between the conductor and the external field of 90 degrees, we can get a DC current of a colossal 65 million amps. Now, by comparison, the highest recorded electrical current so far is 100,000 amps. This was achieved by scientists in Japan in 2014 by stacking superconducting tape. Now, even this 100,000 is still a good 650 times weaker than that required in our calculation. This is a document entitled Nikola Tesla's Electromagnetic Field Lift. In it, Nikola Tesla demonstrates how high-powered electricity of high frequency tends to travel over its surface rather than within it. It then goes on to describe a type of flying saucer based on this principle, with its outside bottom covered by wedge-shaped copper or aluminum sheets and covered by ceramic outer casing. High voltage electricity, controlled by transformers, would then flow out, over, and between these sheets, giving off strong electromagnetic fields, which would interact strongly with the Earth's energy fields. Now, this is a fascinating concept, but as Tesla worked with high power alternating currents, one might wonder how alternating currents could result in a net push against the Earth's magnetic field, which is actually a DC field. It seems that there would be alternating push and pulls due to the alternating repulsions and attractions,
instead of a singular polarized force. However, the paper explains that the higher the frequency of the electricity, the more it pushes against the Earth's electrostatic and electromagnetic fields. So this suggests a type of reactionary gradient, whereas low frequency currents like the 50 and 60 Hertz currents coming from a home outlet would experience the alternating first forces, while higher frequencies would experience a more singular or polarized force. This is an intriguing concept, and it's definitely an area I'd like to research. But there is even more material in the world of fringe science, which might suggest that geomagnetism can be used to counteract gravity. Many who have researched in this area may have heard of the Coral Castle in Homestead, Florida, an astonishing megalithic park created from huge multi-ton monoliths of coral rock. The creator of this modern megalithic site was a Latvian immigrant by the name of Edward Leedskalnin. Being a man of very diminutive height and build, Leedskalnin is considered an enigma, considering his uncanny ability to move and erect such colossal structures without the aid of heavy machinery or apparent physical size. Not that even a man three times his size would have had a much easier time with the sheer size and weight of these structures. Leedskalnin did have some basic lifting equipment, such as a wooden tripod and a block and tackle and chain hoist. A man by the name of Wallace T. Wallington, a retired construction worker, showed that it is indeed possible to move large weights single-handedly using just simple machines, such as levers aided by counterweights and pivots. With such techniques as well as basic lifting equipment, such as a tripod and a block and tackle, perhaps Leedskalnin was able to move his monoliths in this way. As extraordinary as this would be in and of itself, there are still those who believe that Leedskalnin may have had even more extraordinary techniques at his disposal. Leedskalnin had unconventional ideas concerning magnetism and claimed that microscopic magnets were the building blocks of the universe. His theory suggests that these magnets are microscopic monopoles, which are still hypothetical in particle physics, but nevertheless, according to him, the flow and interaction between these individual magnets are what are responsible for the phenomena and forces we observe in nature, including light, electricity, and even gravity. Concerning the latter, he seemed to believe that individual magnets coming out of the Earth were attracted to the magnets in objects, resulting in what we experience as gravity. From this, some have speculated that Leedskalnin may have rendered his stones either partially or completely weightless in order to move them by somehow mitigating or nullifying this magnetic attraction. Though I am still researching in this area, I have not yet seen any evidence of any specific technique of nullifying gravity mentioned by Leedskalnin, at least not except for a particular brief comment in his own book, Magnetic Current, which seems to suggest some type of magnetic propulsion assist. In addressing the rocket scientists of his time, he says, "Make the rocket's head strong North Pole magnet and the tail end strong South Pole magnet, and then shut to the moon's north end, and you will have better success." So here it seems he seems to be referring to magnetizing a rocket in order to assist in its propulsion from the Earth. I remember coming across a similar idea years ago using a high voltage electric charge instead of magnetism. The idea involved the charging of the rocket's outer metal surface with a very high negative electric charge, with the idea that the negative charge of the rocket would be repelled from the negatively charged Earth's surface and simultaneously attracted to the positively charged atmosphere. I haven't yet performed this experiment, but I look forward to doing it at a future date. late New Zealand pilot and author Bruce Casey is also one who believed that Lee Scouten had some kind of very advanced esoteric knowledge. Casey contributed an article to the book Antigravity and the World Grid by David Hatcher Childress, and also wrote several books of his own on the subjects of flying saucer technology, as well as their world energy grid. Casey claimed that the position of Lee Scouten's Coral Castle actually coincided with harmonics for light, magnetism, and gravity. This refers to the unified fields theory, which suggests that all fundamental forces of nature can be related together in a single theory, or that these different forces are facets of a single underlying force. It appears that the jury is still out concerning Lee Scouten. Now, the energy grid referenced by Bruce Casey, David Childress, and others seems to be based on an older idea concerning what are called ley lines of the earth. Though ley lines often have a sort of almost esoteric description in some references, they could actually be understood as the very real and measurable telluric currents and their magnetic fields which travel around and through the earth. Though telluric currents result from both natural causes and human activities, the strongest currents are primarily induced by the Earth's magnetic field and seem to peak during times of increased celestial activity like solar flares, which interact with the Earth's magnetic field. These currents can actually be measured by placing electrodes of dissimilar metals deep into the Earth's surface. Apparently, the energies and frequencies of these currents can interact in complex patterns, perhaps forming regions of higher and lower potentials called antinodes and nodes. This seems to coincide with the more esoteric characteristics of the world grid called power points. These are points of enhanced telluric energy, where these ley lines cross, producing a type of antinode, which is a point of maximum energy displacement in a standing wave system. Interestingly, these energies generally flow between the sunlit and shadow parts of the Earth, but generally flow towards the sun. Ancient Earth scientists seem to have had a great knowledge of astronomical events and Earth energies and how they interacted, and thus would have been privy to these ley lines and the telluric currents and magnetic fields they contain. This brings up the question of, did the ancients have access to their own advanced technologies? Some fringe theorists speculate that ancient societies were able to move enormous weights and travel in the air using sonic and electromagnetic energies for gravity reduction and or levitation. In the book Atlantis, Insights from a Lost Civilization, author Shirley Andrews describes an old tale which relates to special metal plates which help people to fly down the path of a ley line. These plates allegedly worked on both sonic and electromagnetic energies. The interesting thing to note here is that since the ley lines are said to carry an altered form of the geomagnetic field, and since this field and the currents it induces are oscillatory in nature, then one could at least loosely speculate that if strong enough, then these oscillatory currents could induce eddy currents and the corresponding magnetic fields in any non-ferrous metal above these ley lines, hence levitating them. Now here, we could draw a very interesting analogy. We could envision the ley lines and the currents they contain as the flux generators in Eric Lathwaite's maglev track, and the curious metal plates referenced by Andrews as the floating metal plates that he used. We should also note that Andrews claims that some of these discs were made of gold, which is a non-ferrous metal, which is one of the best conductors of both sound and electricity. The only remaining mystery might be how stability in flight might be achieved but as we can see, that too is possible, as demonstrated here by Lathwaite. However, it is still questionable as to whether these currents could be strong enough to levitate heavy weights. Is there any way in which these natural telluric currents and their corresponding magnetic fields could be greatly enhanced by technology? From this, we should turn back once more to Nikola Tesla and his ideas for the wireless transmission of electrical power. Tesla did succeed in wirelessly illuminating a field of lights a considerable distance from his energy transmitter, though the transmission distances seem to be in question, as there are sources which give the distances in only meters, while others up to about 30 miles. But at any rate, Tesla did manage to send power wirelessly. This is actually possible and proven, but many have casted doubt on the possibility of sending large amounts of power wirelessly, mainly because of radiation die-off. The strength of radiation is reduced in proportion to the inverse square law. In other words, the energy is reduced at the square of the distance from the source. However, I believe that there are methods to defy this mitigation via resonance. The Earth's energy fields are oscillatory and rhythmic, pulsing at about 7.83 Hz. This is known as the Schumann resonance, and is known as the heartbeat of the Earth. It is dependent primarily on the dimensions of the Earth, and it follows as this is the Earth is essentially a giant cavity, and therefore should resonate in the electromagnetic and sonic spectrums when exposed to electrical and vibrational stimuli. The Earth already acts as a good conductor to certain frequencies, but could frequencies that are harmonics of and in phase with these Schumann resonances allow for a much greater transmission and reception of electrical power? Now, we have to remember that Tesla never actually had the chance to fully realize his wireless power system on a full scale, as the funding for his last tower at Wharton Cliff was stopped before completion. I also believe that there would not have been a single transmission tower anyway. It seems to me that multiple transmission towers would have to be erected at certain intervals throughout the Earth, particularly at the antinode power points we mentioned earlier. Interestingly, it is said that ancient megaliths, like the pyramids and Stonehenge, were constructed on similar power points in ancient times in order to strengthen and harness this telluric energy. So what if the Tesla power stations were placed on power points throughout the Earth, which would pump electromagnetic energy into the Earth grid at the Earth's natural resonant frequency of 7.83 Hz and its harmonics? The energy would flow out into the grid lines, which would levitate any vehicles that are positioned over them, then would go into uptake by another power station on a distant point, where it would be where the energy would be re-resonated, re-amplified, and then sent back out into the Earth grid. Now, even if this telluric enhancement proves ultimately impractical, it's still possible to approximate anti-gravity or the repulsions from Star Wars by simply concealing flux generators just under the ground, which would levitate the non-ferrous body of any vehicle placed right above those lines. Or non-ferrous metal tracks could be cheaply developed in great quantities and placed under the ground, with the flux generators instead being placed on the bottoms of the vehicles themselves. Imagine floating vehicles that could easily travel over uneven terrain, over sand and rocks without kicking up debris, or even over people without being fatal. Vehicles as safe and ecological as they would be cool and innovative. While some of these speculations may at first appear far-fetched, the core ideas themselves are not science fiction, but are instead science facts. if humanity pools all of its resources and works together, we may actually find that the future we envisioned for so long is actually already here.